Well, and we've talked earlier about the fact that one of the problems with people struggling with suffering is an ignorance of Scripture. And I think that the Bible, and in Jesus Christ, we have all that we need to live a life that glorifies God and is a blessing to us and others. But He, through the Spirit, uses His Word as the primary means to do that. And Scripture gives sufferers at least four things that are really beneficial. It gives them cautions. It warns them about certain things. One is just not to be surprised about suffering. And another is it warns us about suffering that's unnecessary that we can and should avoid. So that's helpful. It's full of comfort. It gives us lots of comfort. We're not alone in our suffering. And it's not meaningless. Sometimes it feels that way. We don't always understand it. But it's never meaningless. And it's also only temporary. It seems like it goes on forever sometimes, but it doesn't. At least for a believer, it's only temporary. And so it comforts us. It gives us counsel or advice, wisdom, which we need. How do we suffer well? And it gives us counsel in a number of ways. It warns us about some of the dangers that we'll face and how to avoid those. And then it also encourages us in terms of the things that God wants us to do that honor Him and are good for us and others. And then finally, it gives us courage or encouragement. Because it's one thing to know what we should do. It's one thing to start doing it, but to keep doing it and doing it, when you're tired and exhausted and so on, it's easy to want to quit. And so we need encouragement in various ways. And Scripture gives us a great deal of that as well. So those four things, I think, and that's why, again, I think when you preach and teach the Bible, you're going to minister to sufferers, because these things definitely are part of what you talk about. And I'll be drawing on these to varying degrees. Each one of the messages I do is an exposition of a specific passage, but in the course of expounding those different passages, we'll be getting into all of these.
What you just said reminds me of something, Charlie, that we've worked with recovery ministries before. What are they, and where do they miss the mark? Because what you have are suffering people that are coming to those. Mm-hmm. And it just came to me. So could you speak a little bit on that?
Yes, most Christian recovery types of programs, they're built on the 12-step model. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the 12-step model begins with number one, but the 12th step is having had a spiritual experience. Now you can take, you know, some kind of relief to the other suffering, alcoholic, drug addict, mm-hmm. pornographer, whomever or whatever that might be. But behind closed doors, we flip that around when I do it. We make
12,
number 12. Say, having had a spiritual experience. And what I find, and it's very interesting, and you have to take young men through this, and older men as well, you have to take them through if and when they do become believers, you have to show them the irresistible grace. And I believe Charles Haddon Spurgeon said this, letting loose the hounds of heaven, you know. So I tell them, look at the things that have happened to you. You know, look what got you here tonight. You can look outside, there's 150,000 people in Clarksville that are suffering. They're narcotizing their sins in so many different ways, including sexual pornography and those kinds of things, but you're not. I said, do you think for a moment that you're here just out of, you know, just happen to have, you know, just fate? I said, no. You're here because from the foundation of the world, God drove you here. I said, look at our mixed group. Would we have ever gotten together on our own? Absolutely not. And when they begin to understand that suffering can also bring one to regeneration, you see, then they begin to understand the sanctification walk even that much more. I'll have them call me up and say, man, I'll tell you what happened to me today. Boy, did I suffer. And he said, that's God talking to me because it's keeping me on the straight and narrow. And I said, that's the Holy Spirit working with you. Yeah. And I find that very encouraging. And then, of course, I have many that will drop out. And I will never see them again and maybe read about them in the obituaries in the newspaper. But it's a matter of life and death, and I make it that. And it's not always condoned by several of these recovery ministries that's the way I should do it, but I shut my door and lock it, and we're sworn to secrecy, not what we talked about when we go back outside. So I feel real comfortable with that.
Well, I hope you're not blowing your cover by putting this on here. You know?
Hey, everybody knows. No, I'm a sanctioned minister in sober recovery and counseling and teaching. Mm-hmm. So, no, I don't mind.
Well, that's one of the things, you know, you're talking about how the Lord's talking to me through the suffering. I mean, you know, part of the counsel is that the Lord disciplines His children, and sometimes. I talked about this briefly on Sunday.
Yeah, you did.
There's suffering that we bring on ourselves, but not always, you know. And in any either event, you know, we can learn from it if we are willing to listen and say, Lord, you know, what do you want me to do?
I agree. Yeah, that's true.
Very good.